Thank you. Habari ya asabuhi.
Good morning.
Good morning. Wow, my name is Reverend Rhonda Clark.
Jina lake ni Rhonda Clark.
And this is my handsome husband, Dr. Ron Clark.
Na huyu ni mume wangu, Ron Clark.
And we welcome all of you that are in the main sanctuary.
Na tunawakaribisha nyote mlio kwenye ukumbi.
That are in the overflow tent.
Wale ambao wako kwenye hema.
That are up in the balcony.
Wale ambao wako kule juu.
And who are watching us online.
Na wale ambao wanatazama kwenye
mitandao. We appreciate and we welcome you to DCI Deliverance Church International Kasarani Zimmerman.
Tunawakaribisha kwenye kanisa letu la ukombozi.
And we encourage you to make this your church.
Na tunawahimiza mlifanye hili liwe kanisa lenu.
If you are following us online, just type in the comment section amen.
Kama unatazama kwenye mitandao andika amina.
And we would love to know where you are watching us from.
Na tungependa kujua unatutazama ukiwa wapi.
Send us your prayer requests.
Ututumie ombi lako.
Because there are prayer warriors in this church.
Kwa sababu pana mashujaa wa maombi katika hili kanisa.
Amen.
Amen.
Dr. Ron and I have been in Kenya now for the past 10 years.
Daktari Ron na mimi tumekuwa hapa nchini kwa miaka 10.
We helping the Maasai and Samburu people.
Tukiwasaidia Maasai na Wasamburu.
And Dr. Ron serves as the president of the Maasai Trust.
Na wakamfanya kuwa raisi wa wakfu wa Maasai.
And I can attest that he tirelessly is working hard to make a difference in the lives of those that we can try to help.
Na anafanya kazi kwa bidii ili abadilishe maisha ya wale watu wa Maasai.
So if you're online, you can follow us at the Maasai Trust, all one word.
Ni hivyo basi kama uko kwenye mitandao uweze ukatufuatilia kwenye Maasai Trust, neno moja.
TheMaasaiTrust.org.
MaasaiTrust.org.
And then help us any way you can.
Na utusaidie kwa njia yote ambayo uweze.
So we would love to hear from you that way. Asante sana. Thank you so much. I would also like to acknowledge someone who is in the audience with us today. He has been with us for almost 10 years. He's training to become a pastor. He's also an associate with the Maasai Trust. And he is our right-hand man. Mr. Boniface Bolimo, please stand. Let's appreciate him. He is family to us. So we truly, truly love you and appreciate you and everything you mean to us.
Asante.
So buona safi way.
Amen.
We both appreciate Bishop Jimmy and Mamacita Alice.
Vile vile tunamshukuru Askofu Jimmy na Mama Alice.
As they've given us this platform today to speak.
Kwa kutupa madhabahu haya leo tunene.
And so we're so grateful for the invitation to come and preach with for you today.
Na hivyo basi tunashukuru kwa mwaliko wa kuja kuhubiri leo.
So now it's my great honor to introduce to you their speaker of today, my husband, Dr. Ron Clark.
Ni heshima yangu kumtambulisha mnenaji wa siku ya leo, mume wangu Ron Clark.
Who is in his 45th year of ministry.
Ambaye yuko kwenye mwaka 45 wa huduma.
That's a lot.
Ni miaka mingi sana. Amen.
So as he begins and as he prepares to share the word of God with us today, I want to read the initial scripture we have for us today. And it's in the New King James Version, 2 Corinthians 9:6-8. And the Apostle Paul writes in his fourth letter to the Corinthians, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows generously will also reap generously. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart. Not grudgingly or out of necessity. For God loves a cheerful giver. Tell your neighbor, God loves a cheerful giver.
Amen.
Amen. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you. That you always,
ili kila wakati,
having all sufficiency
ukiwa na utele,
in all things,
na vitu vyote,
may have an abundance
uwe na utele,
for every good work.
Kwa kila kazi iliyo njema.
Amen.
Amen.
Bwana asifiwe.
Amen.
Let's all reach our hands out towards Dr. Ron and let's pray over him before he gives our message today. Heavenly Father, we come before you today with hearts full of gratitude for your countless blessings. Lord, we lift up my husband as he prepares to deliver this sermon. We ask that you anoint his words. Give him clarity of thought and fill him with your Holy Spirit. Father, we also pray for our church congregation, for opening our hearts and minds to receive the revelation of your financial principles of giving. Help us to understand the joy and blessings that come from generous contributions. We pray for traveling mercies.
Tunaomba kwa neema za safari.
For Bishop Jimmy and Pastor Alice.
Kwa Askofu Jimmy na Mchungaji Alice.
As they return from their trip this week.
Wanaporudi toka kanisani Jumatatu.
May they come back safely.
Tunaomba kwamba waje salama.
Refreshed.
Wakiwa wamehuishwa.
And renewed.
Wakiwa wamekombolewa.
Lord, bless our time together.
Ubariki wakati wetu pamoja hapa.
And may it bring glory and honor to you.
Na tunakupa sifa na utukufu.
It's in Jesus' mighty name that we pray.
Ni katika jina la Yesu Kristo tumeomba.
And all God's people said.
Na watu wa Mungu kasema amina.
Amen.
Amen.
Buona safiwe.
Amen.
Asante sana.
Thank you very much.
You know, I married her at an altar.
Nilimuoa kwenye madhabahu.
And you cannot take away me kissing her at that altar either. I don't mean to offend anyone. But I did not kiss your wife. I kissed my wife. If you're sitting next to your wife, I give you permission to give her a little kiss. It will change your life. Amen. You know, I didn't know that kissing at the altar is not a Kenyan tradition. Is that right?
Is that right?
In America, it's done at every wedding. So if I've offended you, I'm so sorry. Have I met you?
Not at this range.
Your voice is incredible. Are you an interpreter or a translator?
Interpreter, both, actually.
You're more of a translator. I appreciate that. You know, I've actually preached entire sermons where people in the audience would come up and say, the man that was translating for you did not say anything that you said. He made up his own sermon. And didn't preach anything. So please let me know if he makes up his own message today. You know, Rhonda and I love you guys very much. Rhonda. Yeah, Rhonda. There are a lot of churches we could go to.
Kuna makanisa mengi sana ambayo tungeenda.
And we chose this church.
Lakini tukaamua kuja kwenye hili kanisa.
For the same reason that you chose this church.
Kwa hiyo hiyo sababu ambayo hata wewe mwenyewe uliamua kuja kwenye hili kanisa.
And we love our pastor Jimmy.
Na tunampenda mchungaji wetu Jimmy.
And I call her Mama Sita.
Na mama Alice namuita Mama Sita.
Which in Spanish is special mother.
Katika lugha ya Kihispania ni mama ambaye ni special ya mama alum.
And we love them both very much.
Na tunawapenda wote wawili sana.
You're in a great church.
Uko katika kanisa ambalo ni nzuri sana.
Amen.
Amen.
Turn in your Bibles to Philippians chapter 4 and verse 10.
Wa Filipi 4:10.
If this is the first time that you've heard me preach,
kama hii ndio mara yako ya kwanza kusikia nikihubiri,
you can go online to the church website.
Waweza ukaenda kwenye mitandao kwenye wavuti wa kanisa
and find all the messages preached by all the ministers here.
Na utapata jumbe zote ambazo zimehubiriwa na wajumbe na wahubiri hapa.
But I've been preaching quite often on finances.
Lakini mara nyingi nimekuwa nikihubiri kuhusu fedha.
And so if you're just picking up with us,
hivyo basi kama ndio mara yako ya kwanza kusikia,
it would help you to go back and review some of the other principles.
Yaweza ikakusaidia kurudi nyuma ili uangalie hizo kanuni zingine za kutoa.
I appreciate your prayers for Rhonda and me.
Nashukuru kwa maombi yako kwa Rhonda na mimi.
Some of you may not know, but I have fought sepsis.
Wengine wenyu pengine hamjui lakini nimepigana vita
for a year and a half.
Kwa mwaka mmoja na nusu.
And sepsis is a very deadly disease.
Ugonjwa wa sepsis ni ugonjwa ambao ni hatari sana.
I have surprised the doctor.
Na nimeongea na madaktari.
Because he didn't think I was going to make it.
Oh, nimeshangaza madaktari kwa sababu hawakufikiri kwamba nitaweza kuishi.
One doctor says you almost make me a believer.
Hilo jambo limenifanya niwe muumini zaidi.
This disease, sepsis, took my sister.
Ugonjwa ukamchukua dada yangu.
She was my baby sister.
Alikuwa ni dada yangu mdogo.
In 8 hours.
Kwa masaa manane peke.
And she was gone.
Alikuwa ameenda.
And I've fought this now 7 times.
Na mimi nimepigana na huu ugonjwa mara saba.
And today is the best I have felt in a year and a half.
Na siku ya leo ndio siku ambayo nimejihisi vizuri zaidi kwa mwaka mmoja na nusu.
Amen.
Amen.
God is faithful.
Mungu ni mwaminifu.
Now I look like I'm 45.
Naonekana kama na miaka 45 pekee.
But I'm actually 68.
Lakini nina miaka 68.
But I don't think God is finished with me.
Na sifikiri kwamba Mungu amemaliza na mimi.
And I think God has kept his hand on my life.
Na shukuru Mungu kwamba ameweka mkono wake juu ya maisha.
And I'm grateful.
Na nashukuru.
Amen.
Amen.
We're going to read Philippians 4, 10 through 19.
Wa Filipi 4:10 hadi mstari wa 19.
Now, instead of us, you and I, back and forth through this entire scripture, why don't you just go ahead and read it in Swahili so that we save that time.
Thank you.
Do you have a Bible?
Kwa lugha ya Swahili.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, wa Filipi 4:10 hadi 19. Biblia inasema, nina furaha kubwa katika Bwana kwa maana hatimaye mmeanza tena kunikumbuka. Kusema kweli, mmekuwa mkinikumbuka lakini mlikuwa hamjapata nafasi ya kuonyesha upendo wenu. Sisemi hivyo kwa sababu nahitaji kitu. La, kwa maana nimejifunza kuridhika katika hali yoyote nilionayo. Nimepata kupungukiwa, pia nimepata kuwa na wingi wa vitu. Nimejifunza siri ya kuridhika katika kila hali. Wakati wa shibe na wakati wa njaa. Wakati wa kuwa na wingi na vitu, wingi wa vitu na wakati wa kupungukiwa. Naweza kufanya mambo yote katika yeye anipae nguvu. Hata hivyo, mlifanya vizuri kunisaidia kwa kushirikiana nami katika tabu zangu. Ninyi ndugu zangu wa Filipi, mnajua kwamba nilipoanza kuhubiri injili, nilipokuwa natoka Makedonia, hakuna kanisa lililoshirikiana nami katika kutoa na kupokea isipokuwa ninyi. Hata nilipokuwa Thessalonike, mliniletea msaada zaidi ya mara moja. Msifikiri kwamba napenda sana kupokea zawadi. Sivyo. Ninachotaka kuona ni matunda ambayo kama yakiongezeka ni faida kwenu. Nimekwisha pokea malipo yangu yote na ziada. Sasa ninavyo vitu tele kwa sababu Epafrodita amekwisha niletea zawadi zenu. Hakika zawadi hizi ni matoleo yenye harufu nzuri na manukato inayokabiliwa na kumpendeza Mungu. Basi Mungu wangu kwa utajiri wake mkuu kwa njia ya Kristo atawapeni mahitaji yenu yote.
Everybody said, there are a couple of points that I want to make about this message. It's coming from the Apostle Paul. He talks about the Philippian church being the only church that supported him in his ministry. Now, can you tell me how many large churches are referred to in the book of Revelation? How many are there? Seven churches. There are actually 12 churches, if I remember correctly, mentioned in the New Testament. But it's sufficient to say that the largest churches, like the church at Ephesus and the Corinthian church, even when he came to preach, didn't give him anything. Macedonia was one of the poorest areas. And of the poorest areas, the Philippian church was one of the poorest churches. And they took care of him. Do you find that amazing? And you say, oh, that would never happen here. Do you know, I have preached in Kenyan churches bigger than this church and not received any offering. Now, even though I look like $1 million, I don't have another job. And Mom and I have to rely on our ministry to take care of us. I remember having malaria back in, I think it was 2018 that you had gone home for Christmas. And it was the fifth time that I had had malaria. I don't know what it is with me and African sickness. But sepsis malaria and typhoid.
Sepsis, malaria na typhoid.
And out of them all, the Lord has delivered me. As well as some good doctors. But for some reason, I couldn't get access to any money. Which meant that I couldn't pay for any medicine or to visit a doctor. And it was a church that's in a slum that raised 15,000 shillings and sent it to me and said, I'm not sure why, but the Lord moved upon us that you need help. And bought me the medicine that helped me to get well. And paid for the doctor that I needed to see. Can we thank God for that? Your neighbor
jirani yako
may need some help.
Anaweza hitaji msaada.
And because you're a believer
na kwa sababu wewe unaamini,
and sensitive to the Holy Spirit,
na unasikia sauti ya Roho Mtakatifu,
he might ask you
anaweza akakuomba
to bring something home for them.
Umletee kitu ama mpelekee kitu.
If your neighbor, for example, let's say she's sick and she has four children. Maybe you cook a meal.
Pengine umepika chakula.
And you take it to the children. Or maybe you make some soup.
Ama pengine upike supu.
And a nice piece of bread or chapati.
Na kipande kizuri cha mkate ama chapati.
And a cup of tea.
Na kikombe cha chai.
And you take it to her and say,
na umpelekee umwambie,
I just want to bless you.
Nataka kukubariki.
And let me say a prayer for you.
Hebu ni kuombe.
That you'll recover.
Ili upate uponyaji.
That is your greatest witness.
Huyo ndiye atakuwa shahidi wako mkuu.
What impresses you the most?
Ni nini ambacho kinakupendeza sana?
Helping someone?
Kumsaidia mtu?
Or just telling them Jesus loves you?
Ama kumwambia tu kwamba Yesu anakupenda.
Helping someone.
Misaidia.
Now, I didn't come here to start the Messiah Trust. Rhonda and I went home during COVID because nothing was moving. But we came back and found that the Messiah were in a great crisis. At that time, about 70 or 90,000 had died. From what they call the drought of the burning sun.
Tokana na kiangazi.
And it's the worst drought that the Messiah have faced in 100 years.
Na ilikuwa ni kiangazi kibaya zaidi ambao wamasai wamepitia kwa miaka 100.
The government is not very close to them because they live in sometimes very distant areas. So even the government may not be aware of all that has been happening among them. In fact, it was easier for us to find out how many of their cows had died because of the livestock ministry.
Kwa kweli ilikuwa ni rahisi kwetu kutambua idadi ya mifugo ambao walikuwa wamekufa sababu ya wizara ya mifugo.
Then to find out how many Messiah had died.
Ilikuwa ni rahisi kutambua ng'ombe ambao walikuwa wamekufa kinyume na Masai ambao walikuwa wamekufa.
Don't tell me we care more about the cows than the people.
Usiniambie kwamba tunawajali ng'ombe zaidi kuliko wanadamu.
But we have to contact each of the clans.
Lakini lazima tufikie kila jamii
to find out what's happening with them.
Ili tutambue ama tujue ni nini kinafanyika kuwahusu.
And as of today, based on what we can surmise,
na kufikia leo kulingana na kile ambacho tumetambua,
76 Maasai die each day.
Wa Maasai 76 hufa kila siku.
And nearly 140,000 have died since 2019.
Na karibu 1,140 wamekufa tangu mwaka 2019.
You took a survey in 2019 that said there was 1.2 million Maasai.
Tulifanya uchunguzi mwaka 2019 ambao ulisema kwamba kuna wa Maasai milioni 1.2.
It's now below 800,000.
Sasa wamepungua, wamefikia 1,800.
So would you join Rhonda and I?
Hivyo basi uweze ukajiunga na Rhonda na mimi
and put the Maasai on your prayer list.
Ili tuwaweke wa Maasai kwenye orodha yetu ya maombi.
And don't just say pole sana.
Na usiseme tu pole sana.
Say pole sana and help somebody.
Useme pole sana na umsaidie mtu.
Because if the continuing trend continues till not to the year 2050.
Kwa sababu mambo yakiendelea vile alivyo hadi mwaka 2050,
the Maasai as a tribe will not exist.
Wa Maasai kama kabila watakuwa wameisha.
And 12% of your budget for your national government comes from tourism. Now they're not coming to see the Kikuyu or the Kamba or the Kisi or the Teso. A few will come to see the Luya, right, Boni? They're not coming to see the Mijikanda. But they travel from America and Europe to see the Maasai living that traditional life that they live.
Lakini huwa wanasafiri toka Marekani na Ulaya kuja kuona jinsi ambavyo Maasai wanaishi.
Now, just because you can't see them doesn't mean they don't exist. And they need help. So at 68, and my wife, she's what? Are you 25? We've left our five grandchildren, our three children. Our mothers and brothers and sisters, and we're here with you, being a blessing to you and trying to be a blessing to those Maasai people. Now you know a little of our story. Amen.
Amen.
One church helped this great apostle. And maybe, I don't know, I don't see anybody out there helping them very
much.
The Somalis have received $8 billion. And some of the Ethiopians. And the Horn of Africa.
Pale kwenye upembe wa Afrika.
But very little has ever come to the Maasai.
Lakini ni pesa ndogo tu ambazo zimewajia wa Maasai.
So they need our faith.
Na hivyo basi wanahitaji imani.
Now, I didn't ask the last service, would you join with me and let's say a prayer for them?
Je, waweza kujiunga nami ili tuwaombe?
Are there any Maasai that are here?
Sijui kama pana waumini hapa.
I don't see any. Let's say a quick prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus,
Baba, katika jina la Yesu,
we pray for our brothers and sisters,
tunaombea ndugu na dada zetu,
the Maasai,
wa Maasai,
and the Samburu.
Na wa Samburu.
We ask God that you intervene in their life.
Tukiomba Bwana kwamba utaingilia katika maisha yao.
That you supply all that they need according to your riches and glory.
Kwamba utawapa mahitaji yao yote kulingana na ukuu wako katika neema.
We pray for a physical breakthrough.
Tunaomba kwamba uko wape upenyo.
As well as a spiritual.
Hata upenyo wa kiroho.
And we put these precious people
na tunaweka hawa watu wa dhamana
into your hands.
Katika mikono yako.
In Jesus' name.
Katika jina la Yesu.
Amen.
Amen.
Can I have an amen?
Amen.
I'll preach till 11 o'clock tonight if you don't start saying amen.
Usiposema amina nitahubiri hadi saa 5 usiku.
Do you, how many of you come from a tribe that are farmers?
Ni wangapi ambao umetoka kwenye kabila la wakulima?
Any farmer, like Boney is a farmer.
Ambaye ni mkulima.
He can take an acre of land and turn it into months of meals.
Anaweza akachukua ekari ya shamba kalifanya vyakula.
How many of you come from a land that's like that? You're Luya or one of the farming tribes?
Wangapi wametoka kwenye kabila ambalo na wakulima?
How many of you are Luo?
Wangapi ni Waluo?
Any Luos? You know fishing.
Wajua kuvua samaki.
Do you know when I explain fishing, like when Jesus cast the net over the boat side and he got a net breaking, boat sinking load of fish, the Maasai don't get it. They don't see any fish. Maybe some of them don't even know what a fish is. But what Jesus was trying to do is speak in a language that they understood and provide them a spiritual principle that they wouldn't forget. There is a law which is different than what do you call it? A theory? Give me a theory that you know. Anybody, give me a theory. Huh?
The theory of the creation of the earth.
Okay. We only know what we're told in the scripture. But a law is something that works like the law of gravity.
Sheria ni kitu ambacho hufanya kazi.
What's your name?
Mina.
Hilton. Hilton, like the hotel.
Yes, like the hotel.
If Hilton and I jump off this edge,
ikiwa tutaruka toka kwenye huu kingo,
how many of you believe we'll float?
Ni wangapi wanaamini tutaelea tu hapa?
How many of you believe we'll crash to that ground down
there? Ni wangapi wanaamini kwamba tutaanguka pale chini?
And how many of you know better than to step off a ledge this big without getting hurt? How many of you know that you better walk the steps? Now it's amazing that you have to teach children this. I remember when Rhonda was teaching our children that the stove is hot. And Wilson, one of our boys, did not believe her. It was hot to everybody else, but he, at his young age, thought that he could touch it. Now, I can guarantee you, if you touch a burning stove, it's
going
to touch you back. But I can guarantee you that having done it one time, He's 35 years old. He has three children of his own. And he's never touched another one again. Some of these principles that you're learning, once you get it, you own it. And one of those is this principle of sowing and reaping. Rhonda read in 2 Corinthians
9:6.
But this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Did you get that right?
Yes.
You sure?
Atavuna kidogo.
No, I'm just kidding. And he who sows bountifully
Na yule anayepanda kwa utele
will reap bountifully.
Atavuna kwa utele.
Now, I was in Kitale and I held a revival. I think I mentioned this to you some months and months ago. Did I tell you the story about holding a revival there?
Nilikuwa Kitale na nikafanya mkutano ufufuo.
And it was a very big church.
Na ilikuwa ni kanisa kubwa sana.
And it was filled with farmers.
Na ilikuwa na wakulima wengi.
And they understood what sowing and reaping is. They understand that if they didn't sow,
na wakaelewa kwamba wasipopanda,
they would not reap.
Hawangevuna.
But some man had come from the outside.
Lakini pana watu ambao walikuwa wametoka nje.
And he had been taught poorly.
Na alikuwa amefunzwa vibaya.
And thought that all he needed to do was pray.
Na akafikiri kwamba alichohitaji kufanya ni kuomba tu.
Over his acreage.
Juu ya shamba lake kubwa.
And that he would get a crop.
Alafu angepata mavuno.
And so he fasted and prayed.
Na hivyo akafunga na kuomba.
Which I'm not against fasting and praying.
Na sipingi jambo hilo.
And we'll join you as we pray this month.
Na tutaungana nanyi tunapoomba mwezi huu.
His neighbors tried.
Lakini majirani wake wakajaribu.
To explain to him that he had to put something in the ground.
Kumueleza kwamba lazima angepanda kwenye ardhi.
But he did not understand them.
Lakini hakuwaelewa.
Much like Wilson didn't understand how hot that stove really was.
Jinsi ambavyo Wilson hakuelewa jinsi ambavyo jiko liko moto.
So he fasted and prayed.
Hivyo akafunga na kuomba.
Over a fallow ground.
Juu ya shamba ambalo lilikuwa limelimwa.
And when everybody else was reaping.
Na wakati watu hao wengine walikuwa wanavuna.
He was looking at a ground full of weeds.
Alikuwa anaangalia ardhi ambayo ilikuwa imejaa magugu.
And he could not figure out.
Na hangeelewa.
Why?
Kwa nini?
I went to the man.
Nikamwendea.
And I introduced him to Dr. Toom, who he's passed away now, but he used to own Kenya Seed Company.
Na nikamtambulisha kwa Toom ambaye alikuwa ni msimamizi wa kampuni ya mbegu hapa nchini.
In about an hour with Dr. Toom, who owned Kenya Seed Company, he began to figure out why he was not blessed. Ladies and gentlemen, if you do not give anything, do not blame God that you receive very little. Turn to your neighbor and say, I think he's talking about you. Now listen, I'm preaching to you a message that does not benefit me directly. It benefits you. I'm not here to raise something for myself. I'm here to teach you a principle that could change your destiny. Now, I don't know the percentage. I asked the last service and found that nearly half of them were not tithers. But those same people that were not tithers also were the ones that raised their hand and said they need a financial breakthrough.
Lakini hao ambao hawakuwa wanatoa fungu ndio waliinua mkono na kusema kwamba wanahitaji upenyo wa kifedha.
Now tell your other neighbor this statement.
Mwambie huyo jirani mwingine neno hili.
Say it like Dr. Toom had to tell that man that planted nothing and got nothing.
Sema vile ambavyo Daktari Toom alimwambia huyu jamaa hakupanda chochote.
Tell your neighbor, if you take care of God's business,
mwambie jirani ukishughulikia mambo ya Mungu,
God will take care of your business.
Mungu atashughulikia mambo yako.
You reap
unavuna
what you sow,
kile ulichopanda.
But you also reap more than you sow.
Lakini unavuna zaidi ya kile ambacho ulipanda.
Now one kernel, is that what you call a corn kernel? Bonnie, I need some expert advice from a farmer. If I plant one kernel what will that produce for me?
Nikipanda mbegu moja nitapata nini?
Don't drop me now, brother. You got me hanging out here. One kernel will produce what? About. Average. Say it again so everybody can hear you.
Okay. If you plant one seed of maize,
ukipanda mbegu moja ya mahindi,
then it is probable you can get like 200 of the seeds, because one head of one maize, it has like 100 to 200 seeds on it. So if you plant one seed, you stand a chance to have like 400 of them.
Now, you showed me what you planted at your house or your homestead,
yes,
your grandmother's house that she left you, that acre.
Yes.
Well, it was your mother, it was your grandmother.
Yes, yes.
And you planted well.
Na ukapanda vizuri.
And it's been cared for properly.
Na ikashughulikiwa vizuri.
And it's as tall as me.
Ikawa mrefu kama mimi.
Now, when you plant and care for the seed well,
ukipanda na utunze mbegu,
you might even get more.
Hata uweze ukapata zaidi.
Say this, I'll reap what I sow.
Sema nitavuna nilichopanda.
I will actually reap more than I sow.
Kwa kweli nitavuna zaidi ya kile ambacho nilipanda.
Because sowing and reaping is a law.
Kwa sababu kupanda na kuvuna ni sheria.
It works every time.
Huwa inafanya kazi kila wakati.
That I work it.
Wakati nimeitumia.
Now, how many of you need a financial blessing?
Ni wangapi wanahitaji baraka ya kifedha?
You have a bill or you have a financial problem and you need a breakthrough.
Pengine una shida ya kifedha na unahitaji upenyo.
Lift up your right hand. That includes just about every person here. Now, ask your neighbor, now that we've heard how sowing and reaping works, are you going to start tithing? Yes. Look, I was not told to say any of this. Bishop, trust me.
Sikuomba liseme lolote nalosema.
To teach you the word.
Askofu ananiamini nikufunze neno.
But if you don't start giving,
lakini usipoanza kutoa,
don't blame anyone.
Usimlaumu yeyote.
Much less God,
hasa Mungu,
for your financial failure.
Kwa sababu ya shida zako za kifedha.
Now, the more you give,
anavyokupa zaidi,
the more you'll receive.
Unavyotoa zaidi, ndivyo unavyopokea zaidi.
It is proportional.
Inalingana.
If you sow a little,
ikiwa utapanda kidogo tu,
the scripture teaches us,
maandiko yanatufunza,
you'll reap a little.
Utavuna kidogo.
And if that's okay with you, that's okay with me.
Lakini kama ni sawa kwako basi, kwangu pia ni sawa.
But if you sow bountifully,
lakini ukipanda kwa utele,
as Rhonda read to us,
jinsi tulisoma na Rhonda,
you'll reap,
utavuna,
bountifully,
kwa utele.
Amen?
Amen.
This works every time.
Hili hufanya kazi kila wakati.
But one thing that I find often in Kenya,
lakini jambo moja ambalo huwa nalipata hapa Kenya mara nyingi,
is that you expect that I put that seed in the ground,
ni kwamba huwa tunatarajia kwamba tapanda ile mbegu kwenye ardhi,
and tomorrow it's going to give me everything I need.
Na kesho itanipa kile ninachohitaji.
There's very little patience.
Kwamba pana uvumilivu ndogo sana.
But Boni, you planted that corn when?
Lakini Boni ulipanda hayo mahindi.
Hello, I planted on March, the beginning of the March.
Mwezi wa tatu.
March, and what are we now?
We're April, in June.
June. Yes. So when are you going to harvest?
In the end of July or August.
August.
Yes.
And it'll have reached what we call maximum yield.
Yes.
And you're going to share some of that with Rhonda now, right?
Yes.
You see, sowing and reaping is a process. Now, you can plant grass. And it'll grow fast. But then it'll disappear fast. So the bigger that you plant, the longer it takes. So mixed in the giving and receiving, in the middle of that is called patience. You don't sow the seed and forget it, but you patiently care for it, pulling the weeds, watering the seed, caring for the ground to get the maximum yield. How many of you understand that? Turn to Mark chapter 12, verses 41 through 44. Can I read it in English, or do you want to just let's let our dear brother help you here real quick? In fact, everybody, let's read it together. Wait a minute. All of us read it together, starting at the beginning. Yesu. Go ahead and lead them, sir. Go ahead. Help them.
Akawa anatazama jinsi watu wengi walivyokuwa wakitoa fedha na kuzitia katika hazina ya hekalu. Matajiri wengi walitoa fedha nyingi. Hapo akaja mama moja, jane maskini, akatoa sarafu mbili ndogo za fedha. Hapo Yesu akawaita wanafunzi wake. Akawaambia, kweli nawaambieni, mama huyu mjane maskini ametia katika sanduku la hazina kiasi kikubwa kuliko walichotia wengine wote.
Now,
alitoa kutokana na ziada ya mali zao, lakini huyu mama, ingawa ni maskini, ametoa yote aliyokuwa nayo. Ametoa kila kitu alichohitaji kwa kuishi.
Now, this lady that gave at the treasury of the temple reminds me of my granny. Now, I had a big church in America. We had 5 services a day and maybe between 9 and 1500 people could be in each service. My granny loved to watch me preach. She was so proud of me. And she would sit for several sermons just because she love to see me preach. So when I received the offerings and the tithe, everybody would come and give. But they knew that if my grandmother was there, she would be honored and on the front row. But she walked with a walker.
Na alikuwa anatembea akiwa anajisaidia kwa.
She had been in a very bad car accident in 1962.
Kwa sababu alikuwa kwenye ajali mbaya sana mwaka 1962.
That had broken every bone in her body.
Ambayo ilikuwa imevunja kila mfupa kwenye mwili wake.
So the fact that she could even walk.
Na hivyo basi ukweli kwamba alikuwa hata anatembea.
Much like Rhonda's testimony when she fractured her spine in 5 places.
Jinsi ambavyo Rhonda pia alikuwa amevunjika uti wa mgongo kwa katika sehemu tano.
And was paralyzed for 2 years until God gave her her miracle.
Amen.
Thank God for that. You would clap a lot more if it was you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
But my the church, because they loved my granny, were patient. And she would walk like this. It could take 10 minutes. And then when she got to the bucket, I had businessmen in the church that were tithers, and they would put in much more than my grandmother ever had. But God wasn't looking at the amount. He was looking at the heart. And so my grandmother would make it down to the bucket. She would reach in her purse that was larger than it was a big purse. Pull out her little change. Do you know what I'm saying? A change purse. Do you have that? Those here, where you put your dollars and your shillings and your change. And she would dump out everything she had. And the people would cheer like she had just given $1 million. Because they knew that my grandmother was giving all she had. She held nothing back. Very few businessmen, because of the love of money, are willing to give everything they have. If you had $1 billion, could the Holy Spirit say to you, like the rich young ruler said to Jesus, could the Holy Spirit say to you, I want you to go down right now and I want you to give everything that you have in your checkbook to the church? And you'd say, I think I'm hearing the devil. That can't be God. You see, the more you have, the more faith you need. But God is not... Look, do you know the story of the rich young ruler? Rhonda, did I include that in here somewhere? I think I did. Give me a second. Yes, here it is. Go to Luke chapter 19.
Luke 19.
And I think it's on, no, 16 and verse 19. And we're going to read all the way to 31. And let's read it out loud together, starting with 19. And dear brother, take this and lead the reading so that we keep moving through this as quickly as we can without stumbling on ourselves. Go ahead.
Alikuwa na mtu mmoja tajiri ambaye alikuwa anavaa mavazi ya bei kubwa sana ya rangi ya zambarao na ya kitani safi na kufanya sherehe kila siku. Na mlangoni pa huyo tajiri kulikuwa na maskini mmoja jina lake Lazaro ambaye alikuwa amejaa vidonda. Lazaro alitamani kupewa makombo yaliyoanguka kutoka mezani mwa huyo tajiri. Na zaidi ya hayo, mbwa walikuwa wanakuja na kuramba vidonda vyake. Basi, huyo maskini akafa, nao malaika wakamchukua. Wakamweka karibu na Abrahamu, na yule tajiri pia akafa, akazikwa. Huyo tajiri, akiwa na mateso makali huko kuzimu, akainua macho yake, akamuona Abrahamu kwa mbali na Lazaro karibu naye. Basi, akaita kwa sauti, Babu Abrahamu, nionee huruma, umtume Lazaro angalau, achovye ncha ya kidole chake katika maji, auburudishe ulimi wangu, maana ninateseka mno katika moto huu.
Are we there?
25. Lakini Abrahamu akamjibu, kumbuka mwanangu, kwamba ulipokea mema yako katika maisha, naye Lazaro akapokea mabaya. Sasa lakini, yeye anatulizwa nawe unateswa. Licha ya hayo, kati yetu na nyinyi kumewekwa shimo kubwa, ili wanaotaka kuja kwenu kutoka huku wasiweze. Wanaotaka kutoka kwenu kuja kwetu wasiweze. Huyo aliyekuwa tajiri akasema, basi babu, na kuomba umtume aende nyumbani kwa baba yangu, maana ninao ndugu watano ili awaonye wasije wakaja huku kwenye mateso. Lakini Abrahamu akamwambia, ndugu zako wanao Mose na manabii, waache wawasikilize hao. Lakini yeye akasema, sivyo babu Abrahamu, ila kama mtu atafufuka kutoka wafu na kuwaendea, watatubu. Naye Abrahamu akasema, kama hawasikiliza Mose na manabii, hawatajali hata kama mtu angefufuka kutoka wafu.
You know, this is an amazing story.
Hii ni hadithi ya kushangaza.
This man loved his money so much that he wouldn't help anyone.
Kwamba hangemsaidia yeyote.
Now, if there's a sin in the earth
kama kuna dhambi hapa duniani,
that I see most often,
ambayo huwa naiona mara nyingi sana,
in you don't have to be rich to have it.
Na si lazima uwe tajiri ili uwe na hii dhambi.
It's the sin of greed.
Ni dhambi ya kuwa na tamaa.
They that are greedy,
wale ambao wana tamaa,
love their money,
wanapenda pesa zao,
more than they love their people.
Zaidi ya watu wao.
Now this man suffered.
Huyu mtu naye akateseka.
Would you say he suffered?
Je, waweza ukasema aliteseka?
And the man that had all of the money,
na huyu mtu ambaye alikuwa na pesa zote,
couldn't even bring himself to give him a few coins.
Hangetoa hata sarafu chache.
Now one of the things that happens when you live in a place like Africa,
jambo moja ambalo hufanyika wakati unaishi mahali kama Afrika,
is you're around a lot of poverty.
Huo umezingirwa na umezungukwa na umaskini mkubwa.
To the point that sometimes you drive by it, but you don't even see it anymore.
Kiasi kwamba huwa wakati mwingine unapita hata huoni.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
Waelewa ninachosema?
I mean, you're used to it.
Unazoea.
But that does, just being used to something,
lakini kuzoea jambo,
does not remove our responsibility as Christians,
hakuondoi jukumu letu kama Wakristo,
to be a blessing to those,
kuwa baraka kwa wale,
who are hurting the most.
Ambao wanateseka zaidi.
This thing of greed does not just affect you in this lifetime.
Hili jambo la tamaa halikuadhiri maisha haya pekee,
but it can affect you for eternity.
Lakini laweza likakuadhiri milele.
You can regret forever.
Waweza ukajuta milele.
As you burn in the hot place.
Hata unapochomeka pale pahali pa moto.
That you had not done more.
Kwamba hukufanya zaidi.
To be a blessing to others.
Kuwa baraka kwa wengine.
If we're going to be accused of something,
basi kama tutashtakiwa jambo lolote,
Let's be accused of our generosity.
Wacha tushtakiwe kwa ukarimu wetu.
Now, one way that you can do this is be aware of what's happening around you, especially where you live. You might live around people that could use a blessing. Now, I have a few rules on offering blessings to people, and I believe Bishop Jimmy would agree with me. Men, you do not go start giving money to young women because they need help. If your wife does not get you, God will. So it's important that if a man sees in his neighborhood that conditions in a home are not right, and there's no men there, he should send his wife and let her and a friend go and minister to the people. I want you men to stay away from the widow. How many of you women agree with me? Only my wife? Let me try that again. How many of you women agree that men ought to take care of men and women should take care of women? Let me see. Many men with a good heart have gone to a widow's house and ended up doing more than they ever expected to do. Somebody in this room is going to thank me for saying that. You see, this man loved his money. And sometimes people think because they have a lot of money and nice cars and big houses that they're better than people. But do you know that your money does not make you anything? It only tells you what you are. So if you're a generous person, it will be seen in the way that you handle your money. If you're greedy, it'll become obvious. Do you know this life? I at 68, I realize that I'm excited too. I realize that I'm over halfway. But God only promised 70 years. And anything above 70 is a blessing. So that means I'm in my last lap here, 2 years. At 68 to 70 is 2 years. That means in 2 years I will have reached what God promised was a full life, and then he may give me 10 or 20 years above that, but all his promise is 70. Are you with me? Now, I don't want to get to heaven and him say to me, depart from me, you worker of lawlessness, for I never knew you. What I want to hear is what I hope you want to hear. Well done, my good and faithful servant, which means that the money that you and I have does not really belong to us if we are the servant of someone else.
Kumaanisha kwamba pesa ambazo tuko nazo si zetu kwa sababu sisi ni watumishi wa mtu mwingine.
We are caretakers.
Sisi ni watunzi.
We are managers.
Sisi ni wakurugenzi.
Of the blessing that God has given us.
Wasimamizi wa baraka ambazo Mungu ametupa.
Now all he's asking you to do is manage his money.
Kile ambacho anakuambia ni uweze kusimamia pesa zake.
As he asks you to do.
Vile alivyokuagiza ufanye.
So don't be surprised if you go out of the church grounds.
Hivyo usishangae ukitoka kwenye kanisa.
And you begin to notice more.
Na uanze kuona zaidi.
You see that your neighbor next door has lost her job.
Uone jirani yako amefutwa kazi.
And they're starving.
Na wana njaa.
And rather than judge them,
na badala ya kuhukumu,
you go to their back door so the neighbors don't see.
Unapitia mlango wa nyuma ili wasikuone.
And you give them a blessing.
Na unawabariki.
If you don't have something,
kama hauna chochote,
you come to the closet here.
Unakuja hapa.
And you get them a bag together.
Kabati, unachukua mfuko.
And you say, your friends over at DCIKZ,
na useme marafiki wako hapa kanisani,
care about you.
Wanakujali.
Your Lord Jesus loves you.
Bwana Yesu anakupenda.
And we give this to you just to be a blessing.
Na tunakupa hiki ili tuwe baraka kwako.
Do you know when you begin to live that way,
ukianza kuishi hivyo,
there will not be room enough to fit all of the people that will end up coming to this church.
Hakutatoshea nafasi ya watu ambao watakuja.
I prophesy to you, and I don't know how you'll receive this, so I'll let the elders judge it.
Sijui vile utapokea hivyo basi.
But if you begin to live the way that we're talking about,
lakini ukianza kuishi jinsi tunavyosema,
next year we may have a third service on Sunday morning. People are looking for a real church that serves a real Jesus that cares about them.
Watu wanatafuta kanisa halisi ambalo linamtumikia Yesu ambaye anawajali.
Preaching to them,
kuwahubiria,
telling them that Jesus loves them.
Ukiwaambia Yesu anawapenda.
When they have an empty belly,
wakati wako na tumbo ambalo halina chochote,
is not even heard.
Haina faida yoyote.
I really believe that God wants a third service at Zimmerman.
Naamini kwamba Mungu anataka ibada ya tatu hapa Zimmerman.
If each of you,
kama kila moja,
reaches one person,
akimfikia mtu mmoja pekee,
over this next year,
mwaka huu ujao,
we will be in three services.
Tutakuwa na ibada tatu.
All it takes is opening your eyes.
Kile ambacho inagharimu ni kufungua macho yako.
And noticing what's happening around you.
Ili uone kile ambacho kinaendelea mahali ambapo unaishi.
And when you see your neighbors,
na ukiona majirani wako,
who are suffering,
ambao wanateseka,
and you help them not to embarrass them,
na uwasaidie bila kuaibisha,
but to be a blessing to them,
lakini ili uwe baraka kwao.
If you do that,
ikiwa utafanya hivyo,
and then invite them one day to church,
alafu walike siku moja hapa kanisani,
they'll come.
Watakuja.
I guarantee you.
Na kuhakikishia.
That's how it works.
Hivi inavyofanya kazi.
But if you never notice,
lakini ikiwa huwa hauoni,
you never do anything to help anybody,
hakuna jambo lolote ambalo unafanya kumsaidia mtu yoyote,
you can go from two services to one.
Waweza tukatoka ibada mbili hadi moja.
What Kenya is looking for is not more wealthy preachers.
Kile ambacho Kenya inatafuta si wahubiri ambao ni tajiri.
They're not looking for more people that have more money.
Kenya haihitaji watu wengi zaidi ambao wana pesa.
To find a church.
Ili wapate kanisa.
They're looking for people that love others.
Wanawatafuta watu ambao wanawapenda wengine.
As much as they do themselves.
Jinsi wanavyojipenda wenyewe.
And they say,
na wanasema,
If this person loves me this much,
kama huyu mtu ananipenda kiasi hiki,
I need to see this church.
Lazima nione kanisa hili.
You know, I went to I preached at a church. I don't know if you remember, honey. It was Bonnie, you were there. It was in Kitengela.
Nilihubiri katika kanisa.
And there was a bishop there.
Na palikuwa na askofu pale.
And a few years ago, I had walked the streets of Kitengela and all out in Maasai land about 1,600 miles worth of walking.
Na miaka michache iliyopita nilikuwa nimetembea umbali wa kilomita 1,600.
And during one of over a year, not in one day.
Kwa kiwango ama muda wa mwaka mmoja.
But in one of my walks, I had met some men that sit under a covering.
Katika kutembea kwangu nilikuwa nimekutana na wanaume ambao huketi kwenye kivuli
that backs up to the wall
ambacho kimejengwa toka kwenye ukuta
that surrounds his church.
Kinacho unaozunguka kanisa.
And I asked the bishop,
na nikamuuliza askofu,
have you ever met them?
Je, ushaikutana nao?
They've been out there for, well, since I've been here, and that's 4 or 5 years.
Wamekuwa hapo tangu mimi nije hapa miaka mitano hivi.
And this church has been here for quite a while.
Na hii kanisa nayo imekuwa hapa kwa muda.
And he said, I've never stopped to say hello.
Na akasema sijawahi simama kuwasalimia.
I asked the women, when you go into your apartment,
nikauliza kina dada mnapoingia kwenye nyumba zenu,
do you ever stop and say to the ladies that are washing their clothes, hello?
Je, huwa mnawasalimia wale kina dada ambao wanafua?
Do you ever invite them to a ladies meeting?
Na kualika kwenye mikutano ya kina
dada? Or to a supper that's at the church?
Ama kwenye chakula ambacho kimeandaliwa na kanisa?
Do you look and see if some of them may be suffering?
Je, unaangalia kuona kama pengine wengine wanateseka?
And they said no.
Na wakasema la.
We live to ourselves. But we're not going to win this city for Jesus until we look at people and help them and their condition. It's not only important for their soul's sake, but for yours. Now turn to your neighbor and say, he's talking about the people behind us. We're done, but we're not finished. I really believe, how many of you have heard my heart today? Are you listening to my heart? I'm not trying to condemn anybody. We all are judged by the same measurement. But I don't know if you do, but tell me. But I want this church to have a third service next year. Do you? Would you be willing to help add a third service? Now tell me if you... They're not responding. I don't know. But can you raise your right hand if you're willing to help add a third service? If your neighbor's hand's not raised, raise it for them, because they seem to have something. Now, do you understand that we can fill a third service if you win one person? Bring one person. I'm not asking you to do it all. I'm asking you to go find somebody. Now, as we sit here, I want you to bow your head for a moment, and I want you to ask the Lord, is there somebody around me, or where I live, or where I work, or shop, that I have noticed that might be a candidate
ambaye pengine anaweza kuwa ni mmoja wapo
to be brought to church.
Wa mtu ambaye anaweza nikamleta hapa kanisani.
They may need help.
Anaweza kuwa anahitaji msaada.
Or they may just need someone to care for them.
Ama pengine anahitaji tu mtu wa kumtunza.
If you can think of someone specifically,
kama unaweza kumfikiria mtu,
I want you to stand up.
Ningetaka usimame.
One neighbor, one worker,
jirani mmoja ama mfanyakazi,
somebody that you can start praying for,
ambaye uweze kuanza kumwombea,
believing God for,
ukimwaminia Mungu,
helping,
ukimsaidia.
Stand up.
Uweze ukasimama.
Just one.
Mtu mmoja pekee.
Might even be a relative.
Pengine hata ni jamaa yako.
Think.
Fikiria.
In your neighborhood.
Mahali unapoishi.
Their husband may have left them.
Pengine aliachwa na bwana.
With a dozen kids.
Na akiwa na watoto 12.
For a woman half your age.
Kwa mwanamke ambaye ana nusu ya umri wako.
Those are the easiest.
Hao ndio ambao ni rahisi.
I can guarantee you they need somebody to love them.
Naweza nikakuhakikishia kwamba wanahitaji upendo.
Over in this section you can't think of any one person?
Upande huu?
Pray right now. Say, God, help me to see in my mind's eye.
Mungu nisaidie nione
someone that needs Jesus, that lives around me, that I could work on, pray for and work on for a year. And believe that next time this month, coming up to this month of July, that I will have a convert in this church. Stand up if you can think of somebody. Do the rest of you live with the Maasai people or something? I don't understand this. Those of you in school have it the easiest. There are people that eat by themselves every day. They're the outcast of the in-group. It wouldn't take much for you to make them a friend and bring them. So I'm talking to the youth right now. How many of you youth think that you can find a young person that needs Jesus? And believe that God will bring them in.
Na tuamini kwamba Yesu atamleta.
I'm going to wait for two more minutes.
Nitangoja dakika zingine mbili hivi.
Think. Pray.
Asante. Waweza pa.
There's 4 million people in this city.
Pana watu milioni 4 katika jiji hili.
Half of them need Jesus.
Nusu wanahitaji Yesu.
Lord, give me a name. Give me a vision.
Bwana nipe jina, nipe maono.
All right, for those of you who remain seated, how many of you that are seated are willing?
Ni wangapi ambao mmeketi mnania?
If God brings somebody into your life,
ikiwa Mungu atamleta mtu katika maisha yako,
that needs Jesus, you're willing
ambaye namhitaji Yesu
at least to invite them,
uko tayari kumwalika
to church
hapa kanisani,
you join those that are standing.
Waweza ukajiunga na wale ambao wamesimama.
You know, there's already enough standing to start another service. I hope you know that.
Watu wa kutosha ambao walikuwa wamesimama kuanza ibada nyingine.
I didn't see outside, but I saw people on the mezzanine here that we're standing.
Nimeona watu wakisimama hapa nje.
Now look around you.
Sasa angalia.
If you really mean it and you're not just lying,
kama unamaanisha,
you know it's not good to lie to the Holy Ghost.
Wajua si vizuri kumdanganya Roho Mtakatifu.
If you really mean it, that you're going to this time of fasting begins, is it now? Huh?
First of July.
July 1. Sorry, I'm all the shooting as a policeman, as a soldier. He can't see, I can't hear. I mean, we together we make a perfect pair.
Amen.
What I want you to do is
in
your 21 days of fasting,
katika siku zako 21 za kufunga,
ask God to give you favor
umuulize Mungu akupe kibali
with one person.
Na mtu mmoja pekee.
Do you realize that by the end of July we could be in three services here?
Now,
if you don't mean it, don't stand. But if you believe that God wants this church to have another service, then I am going to pray for you that you will not be satisfied until you've brought somebody to church. And I'm going to pray that for every soul that comes to this church, they will find someone. And pretty soon, we'll have to have those five churches that our bishop has given us vision for, because we have too many people. Now, we're in the last days. And we don't know when Jesus may return. But he wants this church to believe for their neighbors to be saved and go to heaven with us. Now, this is not directly the ending that I had expected for my financial sermons. This is more important than money. Eternity. Take the hand of your neighbor. If they have a name, ask them, what name am I praying for? If they don't have a name, say, I'm going to pray that God gives you somebody. In the next 30 days that will come to church with you. Now, when you pray in the Holy Spirit, it's not your mind praying, it's your heart praying. It's the Holy Ghost inside of you who knows the future. He already knows the person. He already knows how you should respond to them and how you should get them here. But I would not be surprised, based on the love and the integrity that I see in this church, that by August we will be needing to look for another service. We do not have to wait till next year. We can shock the bishop and say, Bishop, we're building the church, and the gates of hell are not going to prevail against it. We're going to fill those five churches long before you can ever get them up. If we have to have services every night of the week to accommodate the lost that come, we're willing to do whatever it takes to keep our neighbors out of hell. I do not want my neighbor in hell. Holy Spirit, I pray that you go before me, that you arrange a meeting with somebody, whether a neighbor, a friend, a relative, or a stranger. I pray that you give me favor, that you connect us
kwamba utuunganishe
through the Spirit
kupitia Roho,
that you give me the words to say
kwamba unipa maneno ya kusema,
and I pray in Jesus' name
na naomba katika jina la Yesu,
that I bring them to this church
kwamba niwalete katika hili kanisa,
and they will be saved
na wataokolewa,
and they will be on fire for God
watakuwa moto kwa sababu ya Bwana.
In the next few years,
katika miaka michache ijayo,
it will be necessary for 5 churches to be built.
Itabidi tujenge makanisa matano
to accommodate this harvest.
Ili hawa watu mavuno waweze kutoshea.
I thank you, Lord Jesus.
Nakushukuru Bwana Yesu.
That you're putting into my heart.
Kwamba umeweka kwenye moyo wangu.
Your love.
Upendo wako.
For every person.
Kwa kila mtu.
No matter what their religion.
Haijalishi dini yao.
Or background.
Hata mahali wametoka.
Or financial status.
Ama hali yao ya kifedha.
Or color.
Ama rangi yao.
You love them all.
Unawapenda wote.
And I thank you, God,
nani nakushukuru Mungu,
that you're going to bring
kwamba utaleta
a harvest
kimavuno
of souls
ya nafsi
to Zimmerman.
Hapa Zimmerman.
Now lift up both hands.
Sasa inua mikono yako miwili.
And begin to thank God.
Anza kumshukuru Bwana
for the miracle breakthrough.
Kwa muujiza wa upenyo.
That's coming to Zimmerman.
Ambao unakuja hapa Zimmerman.
Lord, burden their hearts.
Wape mzigo Bwana.
Don't let people pass by.
Usiache watu wapite tu.
That escape our notice.
Bila kuwaona.
Lord, we thank you.
Tunakushukuru Mungu.
For the souls.
Kwa sababu ya nafsi.
At one time I was lost.
Na wakati mmoja hata mimi nilikuwa nimepotea.
And on my way to hell.
Nikiwa naelekea kuzimu.
And you sent somebody to me.
Na ukanitumia mtu.
That loved me more than I loved myself.
Ambaye alinipenda kuliko jinsi ambavyo nilijipenda.
And they invited me to church.
Na wakanialika kanisani.
And I heard a message that I had never heard before.
Jumbe ambao sikuwa nime
And I became born again.
Na nikaokoka.
And since that time,
tangu wakati huo,
I could probably estimate that I have led over 1 million people to Christ.
Ningetarajia nimeleta zaidi ya watu milioni moja kwa Kristo.
But there are millions more that need it.
Na milioni zaidi ambao walihitaji.
So I pray for revival.
Na hivyo naomba ufufuo.
To break out in this church.
Uje hapa chini kwenye hili kanisa.
And in Shiloh.
Na Shiloh.
I thank you, God,
na kushukuru Mungu,
for the power
kwa nguvu,
and the glory
na utukufu,
that will shine through my heart
ambao utaangaza kwenye moyo wangu,
and that the love of God
na upendo wa Mungu,
that has been shown to me
ambao umenionyesha kwangu,
I can share with others
naweza nikashiriki na
wengine, in the name of Jesus,
katika jina la Yesu.
And if you believe that prayer,
na kama unaamini hilo ombi,
begin to give God the biggest praise you have ever given him in the name of Jesus,
katika jina la Yesu.
In the name of Jesus, we thank you for souls. We thank you for every soul.
Tunakushukuru
kwa praise him. Church, praise him.
Praise him.
Praise him.
Sifu.
Praise him.
Sifu.
He already knows who they are.
Anajua ni kina nani.
He's just going to send you to them.
Atakutuma kwao.
And this church is going to be packed.
Na hii kanisa itajaa.
Over and over again.
Itajaa mara tu.
Until everyone in Zimmerman.
Na kila mtu katika Zimmerman.
Who needs Jesus.
Anayemhitaji Yesu.
Will have heard the gospel.
Atakuwa amesikia injili.
Amen.
Amen.